what is metadata? Well, literally it is data about data. So, let's look at some examples. We often have associated with a CD track. You know, there's online databases that associate with it. Who's the artist and how long the track is and where it was recorded. That would all be metadata. Part of the standards around JPEG, a commonly used compression mechanism, there's a exchangeable image file format, fields, EXIF it's called, which tags the image with various pieces of useful information. The digital cameras will put in all of the information, you know, sort of exposure time, the camera settings, whether the flash was used, a whole bunch of things it puts in there. Very rich, you know, amount of metadata. It can also put in things like location. So if you wonder how you take a picture on your smartphone, you upload it to some service and they geolocate it, they show it on a map, that's because the GPS coordinates are in there as well. People should be very aware of that for fear that they want to take a picture somewhere and they don't want to trace to their house. And some people have had some rather embarrassing consequences when that's happened. And one of the other things that professional photographers will often do is they will put in copyright information, information about who owns the copyright or perhaps who you could contact to license the image. They might even put in the license that it's available under, especially if it's a set of licenses called the Creative Commons licenses, which are available to say how people can reuse an image. So that when you find an image with a Creative Commons license, you know whether you can, you know, share it on, whether you can modify it, whether you can use it for commercial or non-commercial use. And indeed, if you go into Google Image Search and go to the advanced search options, you can actually search by license type. You can say, I want an image that's freely reusable or modifiable if you want to create a PowerPoint or something, and you want to be legal, honest and decent with copyright law, then you should actually be making sure you have images that have that sort of copyright license associated with them. As I say, professionals will often put in, you know, just their name or their email address or their website and say it's copyright me and this is how you contact me to get a license. And of course, for most people, contacting a photographer to get a license, it's just way too much work. And so most people, you know, take the very simple expedient of saying, well, I won't worry about it then. In fact, you know, the reuse of images that are in violation of copyright is pretty extreme. And you know, justifiably, very many professionals are up in arms about this. There's a number of things we should say about this. The first thing is, most digital tools are shockingly bad at maintaining the image metadata across editing. So many of them will just crop it out and throw it away. Of course, many people, when they see a picture they really like and want to use, they don't actually save the image, they just do a screenshot, at which point the screenshot doesn't propagate the metadata that may be associated with the images caught in the scene. Actually, if there's several images, it might be hard to figure out which metadata to take. Metadata and their data are easily parted, and it happens a lot. And you'll see people uploading images to websites that may have perfectly good metadata in it, but the website will strip it out. It is a matter of concern because, you know, many people make their businesses out of that sort of copyright material. One of the challenges is getting the copyright often involves picking up the phone and talking to someone. And if the person on the other end is a lawyer and you're negotiating access, it's going to cost you hundreds of pounds because that's how much a lawyer charges to pick up a phone. So the human-based mechanisms of copyright licensing mean that it tends to be an expensive business. But that's where we should ask the question, you know, could we build a digital means of accessing material that had the transaction cost that you would expect with a digital transaction, which is the transaction would cost very, very little, and the money you'd be paying for the image would be going to the artist or the photographer or whatever, and not to the legal negotiation to get there. And so, for example, in the UK, the Copyright Hub, and there's a company behind that being promoted by the Intellectual Property Office to actually build an online exchange, so you'll be able to go along and for the transaction costs of pence or maybe pounds, you would be able to get, you know, access to imagery that you could use, whether it's your PowerPoint, your company brochure. And the whole idea here is to remove friction, is the way the Connected Digital Economy Catapult puts it. They talk about removing the friction from copyright licensing because digital transactions in this space should be, you know, the transaction itself costs fractions of a pence, and then you're just paying for the image rights to reuse it. And I think at the point at which, you know, that becomes a prevalent way of operating and the cost structure is right, then actually, you know, people will certainly those working for corporates, they want to be legal and respect copyright, and we simply haven't today given them the technology tools that enable that.
It strikes me it's a similar kind of battle, although it's legally slightly different to the MP3 thing. People obviously download music for free, but we do have at least mechanisms for buying music, if not necessarily licensing.
When you buy it, you are licensing it. You are licensing it for your personal use. And a recent change to the law in the UK means that you can switch it between formats, format switching, as long as it's for your own personal use. When you go and buy something from iTunes or something or whatever, you are engaging, it's in the terms and conditions, in a copyright license, you've got a license to use it for your own personal use. But we did see the same thing a number of years ago. Until those legal exchanges came available where you could get music, people were frustrated, and they had these great MP3 players and a stack of CDs, and it seemed perfectly legitimate to them to take the bits off the CD and put it on the MP3 player. The music industry took a long time to wake up to that and realise that they should simply be the channel that collects that revenue. And if you make it easy and simple to use, then maybe people would be willing to do that. But what they wanted was a convenience, and give them the convenience, then many people are perfectly happy to act legally.
I encrypt something with my private key, and then your public key, and then send it to you. And if we communicate like this, I know that nobody else can read
the frequencies message. And the amplitudes and the phase within that 3.4 kilohertz band in order to get ourselves nearly up to 56 kilobits.